Hello and welcome to the second part of our buffer overflow module. So as I said that in this module I will be assuming that you as a learner have the knowledge of assembly level language, Kali Linux, Spike, fuzzing tool and Immunity Debugger. However, if you don't know or need to learn more about these tools, you can check out the resources at the end of this video. This module is structured into six parts and this is the second part in which we learn about fuzzing. So before I move on to fuzzing, I would like to introduce you to the typical exploit development process flow. So as you can see on the screen that our first step in our exploit development starts with identifying a vulnerability, that is fuzzing an application, wherein we send random data to application and check whether it has crashed or not and analyze whether that crash can be converted into an exploit or not. Then we replicate a crash wherein we create a POC using any of your favorite languages minus Python in this for the series. Then we control the execution of stack registers such as EIP and ESP. We identify certain bad characters that might not be used in our shellcode. These are the characters that the application treats a little differently than the normal ASCII characters. Then we generate shellcode using either we write a custom shellcode or we use a tool like MSFVNM to generate a shellcode. And finally, we update a POC with that shellcode, run that POC and obtain a shell on the target system. So here's a bird's eye view of what fuzzing is. So fuzzing is a method for discovering faults in software by providing unexpected input and monitoring for exceptions. So this basically means that we send random data of random size to an application and see which of our data garners an unwanted response. There are different types of fuzzers. There are mutation based fuzzers wherein you give a sample file to the fuzzer, it manipulates data within the file and then sends it to the application. Then there are generation based fuzzers wherein you give a sample file to the fuzzer and it generates further files based on that sample file as a test case to be sent to the application. You can fuzz a variety of targets such as environment variables and arguments, web applications and servers, file format, network protocols, web browsers or in memory. In this particular module, our target is a network protocol, that is FTP, file transfer protocol. So our target software for this module is Windows XP SP3 and Float FTP Server 1.0. So Float FTP Server 1.0 has a buffer overflow vulnerability in various of its fields. We'll be covering the command field. This vulnerability was discovered in 2012 and it was rated as 10 on 10 by the Mitre CV initiative. You can check out the CV link below to know more about this vulnerability. So let's move on to our application and identify where this buffer overflow vulnerability lies. So here I have two machines, both running as a VM on my system. One is a Kali Linux 2018.1 machine, which will be our attacking machine. Second is a Windows XP SP3 machine, which will be a target machine. On the Windows machine, I am running a software called Float FTP Server 1.0. Now I'll open it with Immunity Debugger to identify a crash and then examine the values of registers upon that crash. So as you can see here that the FTP server is now live. I will now fuzz this FTP server using Spike fuzzer. So I have created a script for Spike that I will use to fuzz this application on port 21. So as you can see here in the Spike script, there are a lot of strings in the script. And if you have a knowledge of Spike, you'll know that these are static strings and only this particular string is our fuzz variable. So I've now run this script against the target software. So I use line send TCP. Then I'll give it a host name 8.43.72 and port number and the spike script, which is mkd.spk in this case, and we'll start from the first variable and from the first test case. So let's see what happens now. So here you can see that the application is receiving requests and creating threads upon each request that it receives. So depending on the complexity of the vulnerability, fuzzing might take some time, or if you're lucky, as we are in this case, you'll get your results pretty quickly. So if you see our terminal window, you'll identify that after this message, the server say the application says that it couldn't connect to the TCP target. And here, so if we move on to our Windows XP machine, we'll see that an access violation has occurred when executing 41 41 41. So this is nothing but hex for capital A. Now let's examine the registers. So we have overwritten EIP register with a string, and we have also overwritten the ESP register with a string of A's that we send the application. Now if I follow this in dump, so I'll see that there are a lot of A's. So now how to identify what was the length of the string that triggered this particular crash? So if you come back to a Kali machine, you'll see that there's a variable size mentioned here. So this is the variable size that was sent to this particular application for this string. So essentially it means that it sent 512 capital A's to the Float FTP server that triggered this crash. In the next video, we'll see that how to take the string and create a POC out of it. We'll replicate the crash, and we'll also check if we can send a larger string and if it gets stored in the application memory, so that the buffer size that we have for our shellcode increases. So these are the learning resources you can use to learn more about the software or techniques that we are using in this particular series. Thank you for watching this video. I'll see you in the next part. Meanwhile, please subscribe to our channel YakshasCSC for more such videos, and follow us on Twitter. Our Twitter handle is Yakshas443 for more updates on cybersecurity and related news.